Thank you so much introducing me. I'm very much proud of presenting in front of my professor, Chi Chandrasekhar. He's my medicine professor who was working as a second unit chief in Sri Ramakrishna Medical College. And I have chosen this topic, Sakya Coordination Group, which is past and present. We all know about most of the guidelines which has been presented as well as the past and as well as present, but I'm not going to touch on any of the guidelines in this pattern, because I want to talk about only what we have done earlier and what we are doing now, because I thought it's been a practicality to talk about this thing. First of all, in 1800s, regards acute coronary syndrome, I think most of the senior physicians may be knowing about the history of acute coronary syndrome, what we have done at the, in 1800s. Usually, there is no treatment that time. There was very high mortality. Almost, if you take 100% with the acute coronary syndrome, the 74% will die. And that time, there was the aspirin is discovered, but it's not initiated for acute coronary syndrome like angina pectoris. And the usual treatment at that time is it's very simple. It's a complete bed rest. And other than that, there's no other treatment. I think, I'm not very much aware of the previous history, but I've gone through the net and all the things. I found out that what they used to do in 1800s. And late in 1800s, the aspirin is initiated as for the treatment for the angina pectoris. And the sudden unexpected death rate is high. That time, nobody had any clue that what is the reason for the death. The issues of acute coronary syndrome regards arrhythmias or the other part of the things which has been diagnosed the later days, that means in early 1900s. When you move on to the acute coronary syndrome scenario in 1900s to 1950s, the treatment part is very, very simple. Place them in a cool, dark place. Dr. Professor C.S. used to say, when we are doing our medicine, what is the early treatment design? This has been taken up from one of his notes, which has been kept in my book. And that time, the treatment is very simple. Injection morphine for the pain, injection lidocaine to prevent arrhythmias. Those were all the things were suspected things. Arrhythmias, okay, it's been managing the ECG monitoring. Just think that it be preventing arrhythmia, just give a lidocaine, that's all. Even nowadays, the using the lidocaine is comparatively very less compared with that. Other anti-arrhythmic agent has come more potent than injection lidocaine. And there is the thing which has been called always hope for the best. And the next thing is, those who survived with the big infarct will be waited for more and more infarcts. Because we are not doing anything that time. And the five-year survival rate is less than 50% in that time. That's the time of 1900s to 1950s. We don't have any other choice of treatment at that time. And then the era being changed from 1950s to 1980s. So we all know that the propranolol is the first beta blocker that has come in, first major advanced drug has come in as a beta blocker is propranolol in 1964. Just before that, there was so many trials and debates were going on before that, before using the propranolol. Then nowadays, we all know that metoprolol is the ideal drug of choice when we have acute coronary syndrome. And in early 1980s, the whole scenario has been changed. That is, intracoronary streptokinase, the streptokinase for the thrombolysis. And with that, there is a threefold reduction in mortality which will happen for all acute coronary syndrome patients, especially the ST elevation myocardial infarction. And the problem that time is there are only very, very few centers had a class busting therapy in 1980s. So there is, and that time there's a, we had a ECG monitoring at the time and a bedside swan trance monitoring. With that, the patient being managed conservatively. Other than that, we don't have any other choice at the time. When we move on to 1980s to 2000, so we all know that in 1984, the first thrombolysis happened with the superkinase. In early, that is 1984, only 10 to 20% of use of thrombolysis been happened all over the world. Because still nobody believed that that will help for the acute coronary syndrome, especially in ST-segment elevation myocardial infarction. Then the late 80s, then everybody realized that there is a use of thrombolysis in superkinase's high choice of drug. So the usage in all over the world we have changed to the 10 to 20% to 70% age. Then that's the first time in late 1980s the ACE inhibitor initiated, especially the captopril is the first drug which has been introduced for the heart failure patients, and especially the statins in 1987 the first statin which has been introduced is rosuvastatin. Now we all know that the rosuvastatin, atorvastatin, simvastatin, so many other statins been available for our acute coronary syndrome with the loading dose and subsequently the maintenance usage. And even in the surgery, there is a major surgical breakthrough happened with arterial graft, especially with the limograft and as well as the remograft and venous grafts. And mid-1980s, the same time that the thrombolysis has been started, the primary, it's a percutaneous coronary intervention program being started with the plain vanilla angioplasty balloon. That's only a blind procedure. That's nothing else. Just put a balloon, go there to the lesion and just dilate it. That's all. They didn't do anything. But that has a lot of complications in that thing. And so many deaths been happened on table, and there was a keep on working on that to how to improve on that thing. And in the early 1990s, so the balloon gave way to the stent. Then subsequently, we have got the best in the world, like circulating stents, the comparable with the barometer stents. We all very much know about this part that from 2000 to the till date, so 2012, we have so many newer antithrombotics. See, we all know only, even we have discussed with Dr. C. Sandrasekhar also, that time there was a dicopril is a drug which has been used for, even now it's been available, but it's a commonly using drug the earlier days. But now we have so many antithrombotics to use for the, even a DVT or other things for a atrial fibrillation with acute coronary syndrome and all things. Now the current concept for the acute coronary syndrome being totally changed. The main aim of our treatment is minimize the muscle damage. So how could it can happen? It can happen only with primary PCA that has to be happened within 90 minutes with the go to work time. With either a parameter stent or a regulating stent. And we all know that where there is no antiarrhythmic drugs there previously except injection lidocaine and now and beta blocker in the early 1960s, and now we have all type of anti-neuroarrhythmic drugs and as well as fewer antiplatelets including up the new outcome of the ticagrelor. We all know that what is the cause for that sudden cardiac death other than the arrhythmias, what it could be. There was another reason for that to say is the ventricular septal rupture and acute the mitral valve that's been acute MR. Those are all the things that are contributing factors for to have a death. So for that, now the new things like mitral clipping and as well as the intracardiac device closure, the BSD closure, the time of ventricular septal rupture, and the primary ICDs, that is intracardiac defibrillator, those all the things being developed till date. And at present, the 30 days mortality rate is very much less than 10%. If you compare with the percentage of death, which is 74% in 1800, and subsequently to the 50%, now you can see that the 30 days mortality rate is, with the current treatment plan, we can rate it as less than 10%. I like to show you a full photos. If you keep look this, we all know that the first photo series is from Bradman, is a god of the cricket. We can compare with the same thing with the name 1950s. See that, if you see him, you can see his, there is no helmet and no glove. I mean, there is a glove set, but there is no arm pad. And you can see the god and all the thing being very less prevented at the time of day. And even though they have been managed well at the time, they got very good runs. And if you look at this man, so Indian legend, Sakavaskar, we can take it as it's like a compare with the acute coronary syndrome in the 1980s. So that time when Don Bradman played only the Indian test cricket, other than that he couldn't get the opportunity to do that together with the no one day cricket now. So for his, for their aim is just like to survey for the 5 days. Even the one batsman can be, one team can play for all 5 days or 4 days or 3 days. Then the era being changed in 1980s that they have been playing one day game and as well as the test cricket. So while he had become a master in that, but unluckily he didn't sign in the one day game. But look at that, look at that, these two guys. See, in 2000, in 1990s, if you look at the guy, so we all now we say that the Sachin Tendulkar. So we can say that he is good at both. So both it is cricket and as well as the one day cricket. And he has not, played T20 cricket anymore. But anyway, he is good at both. So we have came across all the acute coronary syndromes which we are treating with the ACA, beta blockers, cryptokinase, and all the things that you were even antithrombolytics with metalase and all the things. And the other guy, which has been the new guy, the Virat Kohli, he's been good at all three forms of cricket. So the test cricket and as well as the one day and T20. So we have moved up from the where there is no God. No helmet, nothing. We have been moved on to the all the facilities which you have. So, the take-home message is very simple that I want to emphasize that our acute coronary syndrome, our main aim has to be minimize the muscle damage. So, whatever the best thing we can